Hi all, today we are going to discuss about different types of capacitors based on their configuration. First, let us start with the parallel plate capacitor. Let us assume two plates are there, the plate 1 and plate 2, they are separated by a distance d. The distance of separation is d. Let us assume it is lying along the x-axis and the dielectric medium in between them is having a permittivity of epsilon and the plates are having a surface area of s. Let us assume both the plates are parallel to each other. Then electric field will be produced from the positive plate to the negative plate. This is the direction of the electric field. So suppose that each plate is having a surface area S and the distance is D. So we can tell that the charge that is accumulated on the surface is Q. Then I can calculate my surface charge density will be equal to the whatever the charge is accumulated on the surface divided by the surface area. So generally the value of D is very less. So, as the value of the D is very less, so we can assume the field is uniform between the plates. So, field is uniform and we assume that the fringing means the lines, the flux lines will not be straight. They will incline at some angle, particularly at the edges. This fringing is absent. So, here I am only trying to explain the concepts because I am writing on the glass screen. So, handwriting will not come properly. I am providing the complete handwritten material in the description below. You can download the handwritten material from there. Here you try to understand the concept. Remaining you can download from there. There I have mentioned as chapter number 2. I think unit number 2. So, you can download that particular folder from there and go through it. If you still have any queries, anyway you can leave the comments in the comment section below. So, let us proceed further. So, value of rho s is equal to Q by epsilon. So, we know the flux density D is equal to minus rho s in the direction of Ax. We have already seen before while discussing this how the capacitor works. And we can tell the electric field intensity will be equal to, from D we can tell D is nothing but epsilon E, or we can tell that rho s by epsilon. So this will be in the direction of Ax. But here you can see the E is in the negative direction of Ax. So I have taken as minus Ax. Or simply this I can write as, because rho, if you are substituting the value of charge, so this will become minus Q by epsilon s in the direction of Ax. So if you want to calculate the potential between these two plates, this will be minus integration from, you are moving from plate number 2 to plate number 1. This will be E dot dl. We have to move in the opposite direction to the electric field. So this will become integration from 0 to d minus Q by epsilon s in the direction of Ax dot product with the differential length. Let us assume the distance is dx because we are moving in the x direction, dot Ax. So we are moving along the positive x direction. So this, if you integrate, you will get it as Qd by epsilon s. So this is the value of the potential. So we know for the capacitance is given by the charge divided by the potential across the plates. So we can define this by Q divided by the voltage from here is Qd by epsilon s. So QQ will cancel. So you will get it as epsilon s divided by D. So we can tell the capacitance of a parallel plate is given by epsilon into the area divided by the distance between the plates. So S is the area, surface area of the plate, and epsilon is nothing but equal to epsilon naught into epsilon r. So let us now see what is the energy stored in the capacitor. The energy stored in the capacitor we know will be half times of volume integral of epsilon E square into dV. This is already we have derived before, energy stored in the electrostatic field. So since we know V is equal to QD divided by epsilon s, so this is what we have derived. So from this I can tell E is equal to grad V. So if you are calculating the gradient of V, this will become Q by epsilon s, because gradient is rate of change. We are moving in the displacement or the direction of D. So this I can substitute here, integration of volume integration of epsilon into Q square by epsilon square s square into dV. This is what we get. So this will become epsilon into Q square into s into D divided by 2 times of epsilon square s square. This is what we get. So from this I can further simplify. This will be Q square divided by 2 multiplied by d by epsilon s. This will be Q square divided by 2c, or we can tell half times of Q multiplied by V, or this also I can write as half cv square. If you are writing that Q is equal to cv, just replacing, we get different formulas for the energy stored. We got the same half cv square. So now coming to the time constant we have seen in the last class, c multiplied by r is equal to epsilon divided by the conductivity sigma. So from this I can calculate my value of r, knowing the value of c. This will be epsilon divided by conductivity multiplied by c. If you substitute this epsilon divided by conductivity, this multiplied by c is nothing but epsilon a divided by d. epsilon epsilon will cancel, so this will become d divided by this conductivity sigma multiplied by a. This is the value of the leakage resistance of the capacitor. So more the value of the conductivity, lesser will be the value of resistance, or more the leakage current. I hope this parallel plate capacitor is clear to you. So let us see the case of coaxial capacitor. Coaxial, the name itself is telling, they are along the axis. So one plate is inside, so this plate is like this, and there is one more plate that is outside. So there is one more plate. So let us assume both are elongated like this. So there is a plate. So inside plate, let us assume, is charged with the positive charge, and outside plate is charged with the negative charge. Okay, outside plate is charged with the negative charge. Let us assume the outside plate I am numbering as number 2, inside plate is number 1. So inside plate is having a radius of A, and outside plate is having a radius of some B. And let us assume this length of this capacitor is having a length of L. So this derivation, whatever we are deriving here, the same derivation will be there for the case of coaxial cable also. So we can tell this coaxial capacitance is for coaxial cable also. It will work for the coaxial cable also. So the radius are taken, that the permittivity between this, when this is filled by a dielectric material having epsilon. So for calculating this, it will be easy if you apply the Gauss law. So to apply the Gauss law, we have to take the Gaussian surface. We have seen in the Gauss law, the Gaussian surface shape should be resemble your original charge shape, so that the analysis will be easy. So here also I am taking a Gaussian surface as a coaxial cylinder. Let us assume I am taking this Gaussian cylinder, Gaussian surface at a radius of rho. Gaussian surface at a radius of rho. So what I am doing? I am taking a Gaussian surface at a radius of rho. If you are taking this, where this value of the rho is between A is less than, rho is less than D. So there I can tell that the charge will be equal to closed surface integral of D dot ds. This is what we seen in the Gauss law. So this is nothing but the closed surface integral of this D is nothing but epsilon E. So this will become epsilon multiplied by E dot ds. E dot ds. We have to take in the incremental direction of the differential surface. So this I can write as simply epsilon multiplied by the electric field component in the rho direction, multiplied by the surface area will be 2 pi into rho, that is a radius, multiplied by the length. So this is the value we get. So from this, I can calculate my value of the electric field will be equal to Q divided by 2 pi epsilon rho into L. This will be in the direction of the radial direction, or A rho. So we know the V is equal to integration from 2 to 1 E dot dl. So we are doing the integration from A to B, Q divided by 2 pi epsilon rho L. This is the value we got in the direction of A rho. This you have to take the dot product with D rho in the direction of A rho, because we are moving along the radial direction towards inside. So this, if you make the derivation, this will become Q divided by 2 pi epsilon L into ln of B divided by A. So this is the value of the voltage. So now I can write my capacitance C is equal to Q divided by V. So if you divide Q and V, whatever we got, you will get it as 2 pi epsilon into L divided by ln of B by A. So this is the value of the capacitance we got for coaxial cable. So again, we can calculate the leakage resistance. We know RC is equal to epsilon divided by rho. So from this, I can calculate my value of R is equal to epsilon divided by rho into the value of the capacitance we got are 2 pi epsilon L divided by ln of B by A. I have just substituted that here. So when you substitute this, you will get it as ln of B by A divided by 2 pi epsilon into the value of the conductivity sigma. So this way we can calculate this one. So now coming to the third type of capacitor, we are going to derive for spherical capacitor. So the spherical capacitor, the name itself is telling, it is forming in the form of a sphere. Let us assume a sphere is there, where inner sphere is having a charge of plus charge, and the outer sphere is having the negative charge. And let us assume the radius also, the inner sphere I am taking as A, the outer sphere I am taking as radius is B. Let us take this as second sphere, this is the first sphere. So let us assume in between the dielectric is there having a permittivity of epsilon. Again, we can apply the Gauss law. So to apply the Gauss law, so we are taking the Gaussian surface is a sphere. So let us assume this sphere is having a radius of R. This radius R should be between these two, between two plates. So between two plates I am taking the Gaussian. So we can tell the value of Q is equal to epsilon into closed surface integral of E dot ds. Okay, so this I can write as epsilon into, because we are moving along the radial direction, only one component will be there. So ER multiplied by surface area in the radial direction will be 4 pi r square, because it is a sphere. So from this I can calculate my value of the electric field will be equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon r square in the direction of AR. And now from this potential V I can calculate integration from 2 to 1 E dot dl. So this will be equal to integration from B to A Q by 4 pi epsilon r square in the direction of AR. So this you have to do the dot product with dr in the direction of AR. So this will become equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon into 1 by A minus 1 by B. This is what value of V we got. So once we got the potential, so we can calculate the value of C is equal to Q divided by V. This will become 4 pi epsilon divided by 1 by A minus 1 by B. This is what we get. So this is the value of the capacitance. So now again leakage resistance I can calculate from R is equal to epsilon by rho multiplied by 1 by C. So this will become epsilon by rho into B minus A divided by 4 pi epsilon into AB, because AB I am taking as common. So this I can write as B minus A divided by 4 pi into epsilon into A into B. This is what we get. Okay, so this way I can calculate the leakage resistance. I hope up to here whatever we have calculated is clear to you. So in the next class we are going to derive what is the capacitance of that two wire transmission line, how the capacitance will be formed. So after that we will proceed further for the remaining theorems. So if you still have any queries related to these topics, related to the capacitor, different types of configurations, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer to your queries from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.